play it again.
Oh,
Good morning, and welcome to this Eucharistic celebration. The Mass is being celebrated for the parishioners of our parish. Today we celebrate the solemn feast of the Most Holy Trinity. Do not let your mind wander during the readings today. Each of them is very short, so if you're not paying attention, you might miss an entire one. You wouldn't want to do that, for in each case, a lot is packed into just a few verses. God reveals the holy name in his first readings. Paul sums up his message to the Corinthians in the second. And in the general and in the gospel, John synthesizes Jesus' entire mission in three short verses. Let us listen as if each author is speaking directly to us.
Praise to the Lord, a new song. And so we begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And with your spirit. I am blessed, and so I'm happy this morning, for God woke me up this morning. God has blessed me with the gift of this day and the very gift of life. And as I woke up this morning and thanked and praised God for this precious gift that God has bestowed on me today, and for all the blessings that I receive from his bounty all days of my life. Now, I do truly believe everyone woke up this morning thanking and praising God. Church, if you like me and if you think God has been good to you and God has been blessing you graciously all the time, please take a moment at this time to be grateful to God for everything God has done to us and give him the glory, the honor, and the praise and the alleluia that God deserves. For without him, we are nothing. Now, as we come around this altar to once again thank God for all the blessings and to be with Him and to listen to Him and to receive Him and to encounter His presence here on the feast of the Most Holy Trinity, we know that we are not really worthy for this. For there are times we have failed to keep God's commandments, and so we have gone away from Him, for we are sinners. For those moments, we fail to keep His commandments. Let's feel sorry and come before God, acknowledging all our sins and failures. And let's ask for His mercy and forgiveness, that He may forgive us and make us all worthy to participate in this holy Mass. Mercy on us, forgive us all our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. God our Father, who by sending into the world the word of truth and the spirit of sanctification, made known to the human race your wondrous mystery, grant us, we pray, that in professing the true faith, we may acknowledge the Trinity of eternal glory and adore your unity, powerful in majesty. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Early in the morning, Moses went up to Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him, taking along the two stone tablets. Having come in a cloud, the Lord stood with Moses there and proclaimed his name, Lord. Thus the Lord passed before him and cried out, "The Lord, the Lord, a merciful and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in kindness and fidelity." Moses at once bowed down to the ground in worship. Then he said, "If I find favor with you, O Lord, do come along in our company. This indeed is a stiff-necked people, yet pardon our wickedness and sins and receive us as your own." The word of the Lord. Our responsorial psalm is God, pray and praise forever. I'm sorry, glory and praise forever. Blessed are you, our Lord, the God of our fathers, praiseworthy and exalted above all forever, and blessed is your holy and glorious name, praiseworthy and exalted above all ages. Glory and praise forever. Blessed are you in the temple of your holy glory, praiseworthy and glorious above all forever. Glory and praise forever. Blessed are you on the throne of your kingdom, praiseworthy and exalted above all forever. Glory and praise forever. Blessed are you who look into the depths from your throne upon the cherubim, praiseworthy, exalted above all forever. Glory and praise forever. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, rejoice. Mend your ways, encourage one another, agree with one another, live in peace, and God and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the holy ones greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia.
to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, to God who is, who was, and who is to come.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him might not perish, but might have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him will not be condemned, but whoever does not believe has already been condemned because he has not believed in the name of the Holy Son of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Today we celebrate another feast. We've been celebrating feast after feast since resurrection. Last week we had the feast of Pentecost, right? And today we have the we celebrate the feast of the Most Holy Trinity. And next week, we will have another feast, the feast of the Most Holy Body and Blood of Jesus Christ, what we call the Feast of the Corpus Christi. So the doctrine of Holy Trinity is a strange, distinct, and perhaps most confusing one. And it's always the preacher's nightmare. Trying to explain the three is one and one is three is going to be a hard task. And no matter how one tries, and no matter what example one tries to give. Now, the church fathers have tried their best throughout the church history, trying to explain this concept of the doctrine of Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And we always begin the prayer, right? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. But how three can be one, and how three is one, is very complicated and confusing subject. Let me try my best, okay? Let me try my best to explain the concept of the Holy Trinity, and let's see if that makes any sense. Now, let me say it right away. It may not, okay? It may never satisfy our human mind or our understanding, but let me make an attempt to explain. And if in the process of my explanation or preaching, if you feel confused, don't worry about it, okay? Because I am confused myself. I'm trying to explain how, and I think about this, how a confused mind can make the other understand. So please bear with me, be with me, and if you think it's getting too much and your head begins to spin, reach out for some medicine, okay? All right, everyone. So please bear with me and think with me, okay? As I try to explain, and I know I can't do justice to this concept of Trinity because this is perhaps the most complicated and very confusing doctrine. Well, let's try, okay? So let's do something very simple at the beginning so that we all get into the mood of understanding. And I do believe everyone seated here are good at math. Are you? Everyone watching? Are you good at math? I like it, okay? Not that I'm smart. But I like math. All right, let's do some simple math, okay? Good. Let's do some multiplication, right? Is that right? Okay, let's do some multiplication. Good. Let's start with something very simple. Now, 2 times 2, how much? Good. You're all very smart, right? 4. Very good. And 4 times 4? Very good. 16. You're too smart. And 16 times 16? All right, someone is saying that, right? How much? 256. Great, 256. Come on now. So 256 times 256. Come on, anyone? Any smarter? All right. Reach out to your calculator, okay? 65,536. How do I know? I have done the math already. Not that I'm smart, okay? So it's 65,536 times 65,536. How much? I have no clue. I'm sorry. And I think it's getting too complicated, right? Okay, let's leave that aside and do it, make it very simple. Let's do some additions. I think that's going to be very, very easy, right? 1 plus 1 is equal to? Great. You all smart. Okay, let's take it a little further. 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to? Come again? Someone's saying 2, someone's saying 3. We are confusion here, right? Okay, so 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to, you're all saying? Most of you are saying 3, right? I'm sorry. But the church says 1, right? The church says 1. 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to 1. And that is a problem. How on earth, anyone who has little idea of math, even those who don't understand math much, knows for sure 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to 3. Yet the church says 1 plus 1 plus 1 equal to 1. You see the complication? You see how confusing it is? And that is what we celebrate today. And that is what we profess every time. We believe in how many gods? Okay, great. You are a good Catholic, good Christians. We believe in one God. Hold on to that, right? And how many persons do we have in that one God? 3 persons. And that is the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. One God, one nature, one essence, one substance, but 3 persons. So far, so good. Now, we are not saying the one God has these 3 parts like a pie, right? We're not saying that. But we are saying these 3 persons, who? Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, or different, unique, and distinct, and or equal. They're not sharing the divine Godhood, if you will, or the Godhood. Now, Father is part of God, and Son is part of God, and the Holy Spirit is part of God. No, we say Father is fully God, and Son is fully God, and the Holy Spirit is fully God. And so, how many gods do we have? All right. Okay. Someone says one. So let me go with her, okay? She says one, so let me agree. So but listen, the thing with me. So we say what? Father God, one God. Son God, two God. And the Holy Spirit God, how many gods? Three gods, right? Confusing, right? Yes. I know it's very confusing. But we always preface and say, and this is what we believe. We say there is one God, but three persons. And that is the problem. How this one can be three, or three in one? How can we explain this very confusing concept? What example can we give? Perhaps the closest example to explain this concept of Trinity that the church fathers have given is using the example of music. Music, right? Good. Music. Yeah. So now how many scales do we have in the music? Good. Seven, right? Seven scales. We have seven scales in music, right? We say C, D, E, F, G, A, B, correct? Do the math, yeah. Seven scales, and each scales have how many notes? Seven notes, right? Seven notes. All the music, right? All the music in the world, no matter it be jazz, rap, whatever, everything is contained in these seven notes, right? Now, each scale has something called chord. C-O-R-D. I guess I'm spelling it right, okay? Chord. Now, what is a chord? A chord is a combination of three different notes. It's a combination of three different notes. So for example, there is C chord, E chord, F chord. See, every scale has multiple chords. Now, when you say C chord, now the C chord is a combination of three different notes: C, E, and G. Right, Mr. Yed? Okay, we will talk about it later, okay? Okay. You know, he's the musician in the house today. So we have C, E, G. Now, the thing is, all these three different notes. Yes, C is different from E, and E is different from G. Now, when you press these three notes simultaneously or together, it produces one sound. So we call that C chord. C chord, but the C chord is made up of three different notes. And so one God, three persons. Now are these three same? No. They're not same. Just like C, E, and G, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are not same. Father is not Son. Son is not the Holy Spirit. They are different. But all these three notes make one chord, C. Yes. All these three persons make one God. Yes. One God, but three persons. One nature, three persons. God is one in essence, or substance, or nature, but they are three in persons. Have I made some sense? Perhaps yes, but I do know it still falls short. still falls short and still baffles our mind. And you begin to think and wonder, how on earth one is three and three is one? And that is why we have to go to Moses today. Moses comes to our help. Moses, in the first reading, comes to our help. Well, not Moses, God himself. In the first reading, we heard about God again. God's nature, who God is. Perhaps you miss that verse where we read, God came down in what? In cloud. He came down in cloud. There is a key for understanding the concept of God, who God is. Now, in the Old Testament, cloud is a symbol of God's presence, right? Every time you see cloud, and God speaks through clouds. Now, what does cloud do? What is the quality of cloud? It blinds stuff, right? It obscures the visibility. When there's a cloud, you can't see what is on the other side clearly. And especially when you fly, right? Ask the pilots. They will tell you clearly. When there's a cloud in front of the vision, it just obscures the complete vision. And so you don't know what is, you don't know fully what is on the other side. Now the thing is, you know for sure there is something on the other side, but do you know fully what is on the other side? And so God, yes, we know about God, but do we fully know God? Can we ever fully comprehend and understand God as He is? The answer is absolutely not. Now, by that means, can we know about God at all? Of course, yes. I'm not saying you don't know about God at all, or you can't experience God. Yes, we know more about God. We know plenty about God. But the thing is, we can never fully comprehend, fully understand, and grasp with our human intellect and try and say, I know God fully. No. The moment you say you know God in his person as He is fully, He ceases to be God. He's beyond our understanding. So our understanding of God is going to be finite. No. Finite, right? Yes, finite. Finite and limited. But can we know God? Absolutely, yes. Yes, we know God as He has revealed Himself. As He has revealed Himself. Now, having said that, how do we know again that God is three? Right? We know God, yes. We can know God, not fully. But how do we know that God is three? Are you with me? God is three. How do we know that? It's been revealed to us, right? Read the scripture. Read the scripture. Remember the scene of Jesus' baptism at the River Jordan? Right? When Jesus went to be baptized by John the Baptist, as He was walking out of the water, what do we see there? We see the presence of the Holy Spirit coming in the form of a dove. Just not that. We hear something more. We hear a voice, and that is the voice of the Father. Father is speaking to the Son, and the Holy Spirit is coming down to rest on the Son. So we have these three persons, or these God, yes, divine, yes, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And when we read the Gospel of John, In particular, the Gospel of John, Jesus talks about his personal, deeper, and intimate relationship with the Father. He talks about Father and I are one. Father sent me and I am here. I'm here to do the will of the Father. If you know me, you know the Father. If you know the Father, you know me. And now he talks about this personal relationship of the Father and the Son. Then, before he goes back to the Father, he also talks about the gift of an advocate. Remember? He promised the apostles that he's going to send an advocate. And that advocate is the Holy Spirit. Jesus revealed who God is. God the Father and the Son having this intimacy, intimate relationship. And out comes what? The Holy Spirit. And if that's not enough, now before he went, just before he went back to the Father, on the right after the resurrection, remember Jesus gives a mandate. He gives a mandate to his apostles and to you and to me. And he said, go to the end of the world and make disciples of all. How? By baptizing them. How? In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And that's how we know God is one, but three persons. Now, it's getting too complicated, right? Let me stop there. Let me not even try any further to explain. Now, as we celebrate this feast, what is the message for us today? What is this feast, one God, three person, trying to tell us? Now, what makes them one? What makes them just one all the time? I think it is the love between the three. Now we know these three, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, are three different persons. Yes, they are distinct, but they're never, never separate. They're always, always together. Like one. You cannot separate them. Where Father is, Son is. Where Father and Son are, the Holy Spirit. So they are united. Unity. Unity is the message on this day as we celebrate the Feast of the Holy Trinity. Now, what makes this one possible? What makes this unity possible? The perfect love between these three. It's a perfect love, intimate relationship between these three causes this unity. So as Christians, as Catholics, as we celebrate the Feast of the Holy Trinity, we are called to all the time promote unity. Promote love, not hatred, not division. I cannot call myself a Christian if I can't show a little bit of love for my neighbor, if I can't feel with the pain of my brother who's been brutally killed. I cannot call myself a Christian and trying to cause division and hatred. No, I'm so encouraged to see so much love and unity in this country, even in this most horrific time. I'm talking about those protesters. Those protesting on the street. What does it tell us? They are there for unity, demanding justice, demanding love for everyone. It's very encouraging. And as you see, I'm sure you have seen that a lot of youngsters, this generation wants a change. This generation makes it clear, yes, we prefer unity and not division. We prefer love, not hatred. And the protest are the symbol of that. Are they peaceful? Of course, yes. Now, being peaceful does not mean passive. It doesn't mean passive. It doesn't mean just be saying nothing. No, you gotta say something. How on earth will others know if you don't say anything? So should the protesters keep quiet? No. Talk. Explain. And it's a great sign for us, right? But we also know, on the other side, some questioning this very act. Perhaps being a little cynical, a little funny, saying, how on earth? The same guys were talking about social distancing, right? And safety of life. And what are these protesters doing? What are they doing? Everyone close to each other. What happened to social distance? Now, think about this. To those who question this, think about this way. What was social distance in the first place for? Why are we asked to distance ourselves from my neighbor? It is to protect and safeguard my life. Think about this. What are these protesters are protesting for? Life. Life is at stake. Now, you on the one hand, you're saying protect life. On the other hand, you're going about killing people. And how can we do that? They're doing the right thing. Distancing, social distancing and protesting, they both are doing the same stuff. Pleading for life. That all life matters and black life matters. Yes. It matters. And as Christians, we cannot. You know, sow hatred. Let's show some love. Now it's easy to divide, right? It's easy to divide. It's hard to unite. And Holy Trinity is a unity. And we are called to always stay together. Promote love. Promote compassion. We heard in the second reading, right, from St. Paul to the Corinthians. He's asking his followers, Christians, to encourage, not to discourage, to agree with one another. Let's agree at least to disagree. Let's not be mean to the other and try to discourage. And he says, live in peace. This is what a Christian ought to do. So on this day and every day of our life, let us show who we are and learn to respect my neighbor, my brother. Because my brother, my sister is made the image and the likeness of God. Life matters. Black life matters. At this time, I want to pay my homage and remember all those have been victims of racism, violence, and police brutality. And pray for all those who are gone before us. If you feel like joining me, please join me. And let's spend couple of minutes in silence honoring those victims of violence, racism, and brutality. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us stand, and together we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God our Father is kind and generous and always listens to our prayers and answers our prayers. With the same hope and trust in our God, let us now bring to him all our prayers and needs.
For the church, that we may strive to be a visible sign of God's love and mercy in the world today, caring for those mostly in need of both, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That all nations may come to appreciate the value of harmonious relationships with their neighbors, leading the world filled with peace and understanding. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That everyone may look to the mutual love of the Holy Spirit as a model, treating each other with kindness, respect, and mercy, and so realize the joy of forgiveness and reconciliation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That there may be an end to police brutality and racism in this country, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For parents, teachers, catechists, and all those who help us understand and appreciate God's love for us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all the sick, especially those who are on our prayer list, that they may be healed from all their diseases and be comforted in their suffering and pain, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts. For these intentions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers. Loving Father, please listen to all these our prayers that we have brought before you this morning, and those prayers and needs that are within our hearts and unexpressed, which you know them all too well. Please answer them all according to your will and in your time. We ask these through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And brothers, my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for all the good and good of all his holy church. Sanctify by the invocation of your name, we pray, O Lord our God, this oblation of our service, and by it make of us an eternal offering to you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for with the only begotten Son and the Holy Spirit, you are one God, one Lord, not in the unity of a single person, but in a trinity of one substance. For what you have revealed to us of your glory, we believe equally of your Son and of the Holy Spirit, so that in the confessing of the one true and eternal Godhead, you might be adored in what is proper to each person, their unity in substance and their equality in majesty. For this is praised by angels and archangels, cherubim too, and seraphim, who never cease to cry out each day as with one voice they acclaim.
Holy, 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 holy.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it, and gave to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with our Pope Francis, our Bishop Daniel DiNardo, and all the clergy, and all your people you have gathered here before you around this altar. Today we especially remember and pray for all those who are sick and suffering and in pain. May they be healed and given strength to bear the pain that comes their way. Remember also, brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all those who have died in your mercy. Today, we especially remember and pray for George Floyd and all the victims of racism. And all those who have died in your mercy, bring them all into your light. Have mercy on us all, we pray. That the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles and all the saints, especially St. Arnold Jansen, St. Joseph Reinhardtmetz, and all those who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Oh,
our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Whose are your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins and shortcomings, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always, and with your spirit.
Now let us share a sign of peace with one another.
Behold the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are we those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Give myself away. I give myself away. So
for the communion,
can use me.
You may come in the middle, come through the middle aisle for the communion, and if you brought your tithing offertory, you may drop them as you come for the communion in the baskets right in front. And as you come for the communion, please keep the social distancing.
Give myself away so you can. Come on, let him know. I give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. What would happen if a generation embraced this? Come on, tell them, here I am. Here I am. are you.
So you can use me. I give myself.
Let us pray. May receiving this sacrament, O Lord our God, bring us health of body and soul as we confess your eternal Holy Trinity and the undivided unity. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. To everyone once again present here, please know that you are in our thoughts and prayers as we go through this pandemic, right? Two viruses, Corona and the virus of racism. You are in our prayers, and we pray that God will give us the strength and the grace to go through these difficult moments. And also those who are joining us virtually, all our parishioners who are unable to be here in person, please know that you are in our thoughts and prayers, praying for everyone's safety, health, and peace of mind. One announcement, and I don't want to say this, but because it relates to money, right? At this time, I don't want to be talking about money, but just I want to say this because we are making some changes. We have made some changes to our online giving, right? I'm sure you have heard, you already seen that. Perhaps you may have received a letter, a mail from me, what the company is sending on behalf of me. asking you to sign up for online giving. Now, we're just asking, right? If you're not convinced of using internet, please don't do that, okay? No force, we're giving you more options for giving. But if you want to use the traditional way of giving, sending you envelope, please do so. You can mail, or you can also drop your offertory in the rectory mailbox, right? You know where that is, where we priests live? There is a mailbox on Rosedale. If you want to do that, you can do. Again, it's just, I'm not asking you for money, because you've been very generous, even in this time of difficulty. I'm really impressed with our priestness, been supporting for the past 3 months or so, as you've been doing it before. So thank you, and let's share our blessings. And if you don't want to use the online giving, don't worry about it. Use the traditional, and if you can't, I totally understand. All right, is everyone still happy? Everyone happy, church? Be happy and keep smiling. Yes, I know. Yes. Ron is reminding me of something, right? I was forgetting. Yes. Thanks, Ron. Birthdays. Anyone celebrating birthday here? Any birthdays, anniversary? Any birthdays, anniversary? Hold on. And if no one here, I'm sure there's someone celebrating virtually. We are sending you our praise and wishes. May God be with you and bless you and guide you on this day and throughout the year. Let's play the song for those who are celebrating birthdays. As we celebrate birthday and anniversary, on that note, if those, especially those who are watching, joining us virtually, and you, if you're celebrating your birthday in a week or a month, you can go to our website and give us some information about your birthday and anniversary. And I believe you know our website, right? It's org was the old one. It's stmaryshouston.net. You log in there, and you will see, if you scroll down, you will see a picture called Happy Birthday, right? Click on that, and it will take you and give the information on your birthday and anniversary so that we can recognize and pray for you as we celebrate the Mass, and we will have it streamed on the screen, so others can join and pray for you. You know, we are going really high tech, right? And thanks again to Ron and Reed and Braylon, right, for your hard work. Thanks, Ron, Reed, and Braylon. Thank you. Thanks much. The Lord be with you, and with your spirit, and may Almighty God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your lives. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God.
Rain down on me, rain. Philadelphia. Can we take